One of the most iniquitous and most barbarous acts of English politics, committed shortly after the Treaty of Tilsit, excited general indignation in Europe. An English fleet, frighted with an army of 35,000 men under the command of General Cathcart, suddenly appeared off the coast of Denmark. Although the Danish government had done nothing whatever to furnish England with a pretext for an attack, the only excuse which the British government dared to make for this atrocious violation of international laws was that, to all appearances, it was the intention of the Danish government to ally its naval forces with those of France. Denmark was reposing in the security of peace. No means of defense had been prepared either at Copenhagen or on the island of Zealand. And as the whole Danish army was on the continent, it was impossible to foresee any attack on this island. An English agent presents himself, and without opening any negotiation, without taking the trouble to justify his mission, without giving any alternative, signifies to the Danish government an order to hand over the Danish fleet to the admiral in command of the English expedition. And on these demands being refused, threatens to burn down Copenhagen. So insolent an ultimatum could not be accepted. Accordingly, on September 2nd, 1807, a day of sinister memory, there begins, without any other formality, the bombardment of the Danish capital, which lasted with horrible intensity for 3 days. A great part of the city was reduced to ashes, and on the 7th, the governor capitulated to avoid its entire destruction. The crown prince, who was away from his capital, had sent orders that the fleet was to be burned, but these orders had never reached their destination. More than 60 vessels, frigates, brigs, and other ships, together with the entire naval munitions, fell into the hands of the English, who destroyed or burned whatever they could not carry away. The general feeling in Europe was one of indignant reprobation of this act of savage violence. The English ministry replied to the vehement attacks which were made on it on this occasion in Parliament, and declaring that the revelations of secret engagements entered upon at Tilsit by the two emperors had made it necessary to order the Copenhagen expedition. But it was unable to furnish any proof of the truth of these allegations. Suspicions have attached in this matter to Monsieur de Talleyrand's friends. Although these suspicions were never proved to be well-founded, I must say that the emperor had occasion to find out that breaches of confidence had been committed before that time under Monsieur de Talleyrand's ministry, and that important documents taken from the Foreign Office had been communicated to foreign powers. An act of treachery of this kind was the reason of the dismissal and banishment of a former head of the Secretary's office in the ministry, whom Napoleon did not allow to return to France until long after. The triumphs of Napoleon and of our armies were counterbalanced by a misfortune which came upon the imperial family in May 1807. The death of the Crown Prince of Holland overthrew the hopes and the projects which were staked on this child's head, and the realization of which, if he had lived, might perhaps have prevented the emperor's second marriage with a foreign princess. Napoleon was much attached to this nephew, the son of his adopted daughter. In the summer months which the emperor was able to spend at Saint-Cloud, this child used sometimes to be brought under the windows of his cabinet, which opened out to the parterre. When Napoleon saw him, he used to go and kiss him. I used sometimes to see him carrying the child in his arms as he came in to resume some work in which he had been interrupted. Napoleon Charles, such was the child's name, was not yet 5 years old when he was suddenly snatched from his mother's arms, leaving her for some time demented with sorrow. Napoleon, greatly grieved by this loss, sent his sister Caroline to comfort the unhappy parents, who had retired to the palace of Loo in Holland. Queen Hortense left the kingdom on this occasion and went to the springs in the Pyrenees. King Louis accompanied her, wishing to try the effect of these waters on his health, which time and the damp climate of Holland had considerably affected. He spent the months of June and July there. Crew, of which the young prince died, was at that time little known. Napoleon offered a prize of 12,000 francs to the author of the best essay on the means to prevent and cure this cruel disease, so sudden in its attacks and so rapid in its progress. It has been noticed that it was on the same date, May 6, 14 years later, that the emperor was by death reunited to the young nephew whom he had thought of appointing his heir. The deposition of Selim and this monarch's tragic death, which shortly followed, were another misfortune if this prince, who was worthy of a better fate, had lived. The Treaty of Bucharest, which was so fatal to us in 1812, would doubtless never have been concluded. On July 9th, 1807, after an exchange of the ratifications of the treaties which had been signed the day before, Napoleon, wearing the Grand Cordon of the Russian Order of St. Andrew, proceeded to the Emperor of Russia, who received him at the head of his guard, wearing the Grand Cordon of the Legion of Honor. Napoleon had the soldier of the Russian Imperial Guard who had most distinguished himself presented to him, and handed him the golden eagle of the Legion of Honor as proof of his esteem for the Russian Guardsman. He also presented his portrait to General Platov, Hetman of the Cossacks. After 3 hours' conversation, Napoleon accompanied Alexander to the bank of the Niemen, where the Tsar embarked. The two sovereigns separated after the most affectionate leave-taking. The King of Prussia, after an exchange of purely formal visits, took leave of the Emperor Napoleon and proceeded to Memel. Napoleon, on his side, set out at once for Königsberg. The emperors of Russia and France had spent 20 days at Tilsit. Their residences in the city were quite close to each other and in the same street. During all this time, Napoleon and Alexander showed the greatest friendship for each other. Who would not have seen in their intimacy a solid guarantee for the peace of Europe? It is necessary to believe that Alexander's professions of friendship were sincere at the time. Napoleon halted one day in Königsberg and settled the dates on which the Prussian provinces, still occupied by the French troops, should be evacuated, assigning to each army corps the place which it should occupy. The emperor sent General Savary direct to St. Petersburg from Königsberg. The mission of this general, who had received instructions both concise and broad, but which had no official character, had for its object the keeping of the Emperor Alexander in the frame of mind which had dictated the Treaty of Tilsit, and the hurrying on and the execution of the various stipulations of the treaties. He was also to superintend the choice and speedy departure of a Russian ambassador to Paris, and finally to reside in St. Petersburg until further orders. Napoleon then proceeded to Dresden, where he spent 3 days. He received sincere proofs of gratitude and attachment from the worthy King of Saxony. He settled with La Boulerie, general paymaster to the great army, whom he appointed treasurer of the extraordinary domain. All matters connected with the levies on Prussia and the conquered provinces, which amounted together to more than 600 millions of francs. Napoleon returned to Saint-Cloud with all speed and without stopping on the way. He arrived there on July 27th at 5 o'clock in the morning. He dined with his family, the Arch-Chancellor Cabaceres being present. In the evening, he saw the ministers, and on the morrow, he received the congratulations of the great corporations of state. The emperor's return, after an absence of 10 months, the longest he had ever made, was hailed with universal satisfaction. The prosperity enjoyed by all classes evoked a feeling of gratitude and warm sympathy for the man who had just crowned the most unheard of successes with the most glorious peace. The hope that this peace would be durable filled every heart with gladness. Paris was delighted, and a general illumination was spontaneously improvised on the very evening of the emperor's arrival. Napoleon's first care was to develop the prosperity of the country at home and to do everything necessary to strengthen its security, a security which had not been in the least disturbed during his long absence from home. He then turned his attention to foreign affairs and sought the best means for inducing the European powers, including Austria, to declare against England. The realization, in short, of the advantages which he had looked for from the Treaty of Tilsit. Napoleon proceeded also with the organization of the Kingdom of Westphalia, which had been created by this treaty in favor of Jerome Bonaparte. This kingdom had been put together out of the electorate of Hesse Cassel, joined to the Duchy of Brunswick and other provinces in Germany, which had been ceded by Prussia. Hanover also became an integral part of the Kingdom of Westphalia in 1810. Marshal Mortier had been commissioned to take possession of these various states. There was, amongst other rich artistic collections at Kassel, a fine picture gallery, and some of the finest pictures were sent to Paris. Two of these, of the greatest value, the best works of Paul Potter, were offered to the Empress Josephine, who had them placed in her gallery at La Malmaison. One was The Farm at Amsterdam, which is more generally known by a vulgar name, and the other was Men Chased by Animals. I remember seeing these pictures there. They were admired by all connoisseurs and used to be covered over with green curtains to protect them. When the emperor looked at them, he seemed to regret that the empress had accepted them. He used to say that it was robbing the museum. He would have taken more pleasure in them at the museum, because the greatest pleasure that he could afford himself was to enrich France with all the masterpieces which he gained by his victories. Napoleon gave to the new kingdom of Westphalia a constitution, the provisions of which are an answer to the reproach that has been cast upon him of being the defender of privileges and the restorer of absolute power. This constitution, like that of the Grand Duchy of Warsaw, and like the constitution of Bayonne, were drawn up later, consecrated the abolition of serfdom, the equality of all men before the law, the publicity of trials, and the eligibility of all citizens without distinction to fill public offices. Already as first consul, he had given a proof of his vigilance for the rights of the people by causing a special clause to be inserted into the deed by which Louisiana was ceded to the United States, guaranteeing that the inhabitants of this colony should be protected in their liberties, their possessions, and religion. Napoleon sent French commissioners to the new kingdom of Westphalia, charged with the organization of the various government departments and to form a regency council pending the king's arrival. The marriage of Jerome, Napoleon's brother, with the daughter of the king of Württemberg was a consequence of the foundation of this new throne. The interview between the future spouses took place at the castle of Raincy, near Paris. Prince Jerome, bright, witty, and fond of pleasure, was not yet 23 years of age. Princess Catherine was 1 year older. This union, formed by cold political calculations, was soon strengthened by the mutual affection which sprung up between husband and wife. Catherine of Württemberg, whose destiny it was to give an example of conjugal fidelity and constancy under adversity during a period when so many reputations, till then considered above reproach, went to the wall, was a beautiful and interesting princess. From the first moment, she won the sympathies of her new family, and the emperor embraced her affectionately directly when he saw her. The civil marriage was performed with great pomp in the Diana Gallery at the Tuileries Palace, and the prince primate gave the nuptial blessing to the young couple in the chapel of the same palace on the following day. There was a reception at court that day, but the bad weather spoiled the illuminations and prevented the firework display. The king and queen of Westphalia spent 3 months in Paris, whilst the regency council, composed of the three councillors of state, Simeon Bugnot and Joyvet and General Lagrange, was organizing the government of the kingdom in the sovereign's name and establishing his authority. Initiated to the science of government by the emperor, King Jerome had frequent conversations with his brother and was in constant correspondence with the Regency Council. A week after the departure of the emperor for Italy, the king and queen of Westphalia left Paris to enter upon their states. They were received all along their route with enthusiastic welcome, which was everywhere accorded to the name which they bore. They spent a week at Stuttgart, where the king of Württemberg did all in his power to treat his daughter and her husband with respect and honor. The week passed in unending banquets and fetes, What a change 7 years later! The old king seemed then to want to make up for the marks of respect which in 1807 he had shown through his guests to the generous sovereign to whom he owed his royal crown. But Napoleon in 1814 was no longer anything more in his eyes than a vanquished enemy whom he had no longer any need to treat with consideration. The change of times can alone explain such changes in conduct, and these things are amongst the contemptible features of human nature. After Napoleon's return from Tilsit, an important change was made in the ministry. Prince de Benevento, Talleyrand, who, dissatisfied with the post of Grand Chamberlain, coveted a salary equal to that of the two ex-consuls, was given the choice between the dignity of vice-grand elector and a secretary of foreign affairs. Monsieur de Talleyrand preferred to resign his portfolio, but he considered, and not without reason, that his leaving the ministry was the beginning of his disgrace. The emperor, without having material proofs of his minister's infidelity, felt that he could not continue to trust him. Napoleon accordingly thought that it would be more advisable to keep Prince de Benevento, Talleyrand, at hand, and only to take advantages of his services as occasion might warrant. Monsieur de Champigny, whom the emperor had employed in certain negotiations, whose honesty he appreciated, and who seemed to him endowed with the special capacities that were wanted, seemed to him the right man to manage the foreign office under his own direction. It is to be regretted that Napoleon did not remove Talleyrand from public affairs altogether. At the time when he removed the portfolio of the foreign office from his hands for the relations which this minister had formed with certain foreign statesmen, and the way in which he had managed to ingratiate himself with certain sovereigns, gave him powerful resources of influence which he was able to use in a fatal manner against the emperor. Monsieur de Champigny gave up the Ministry of the Interior to Monsieur Cretet, who was governor of the Bank of France, who was replaced by Joubert, the counselor of state. General Clark replaced Marshal Berthier at the War Office, the marshal being raised to the dignity of vice constable, whilst retaining his post as major general of the great army. Monsieur Portalis, one of the principal writers of the Civil Code, was succeeded after his death, which occurred in the same month, at the Ministry of Public Worship by Monsieur Bigot Preeminent, a learned lawyer who, like his predecessor, had worked on the Civil Code. The tribunate was suppressed by a Senatus Consultum of August 1807. This institution had not fulfilled its object, even at the time when it was created. It was a wheel in the governmental machine which experience had proved to be useless and even disadvantageous. The tribunate was composed for the most part of very capable men whom a new government could not ignore. The danger lay in the fact that these men, loving to shine by eloquence and being steeped in the ideas which they had advocated during the Republic, possessed a public tribune from which to preach and maintain the same doctrines. These men brought into their debates, in spite of the fact that 9/10 of them could not be suspected of ill will or of hostility against the authorities, a spirit of opposition and an instinct of distrust which prompted them to reject measures of generally acknowledged public utility, amongst others the so anxiously expected provisions of the Civil Code, the modifications which the tribune had undergone, a creation incompatible with the idea of stability, did not remedy the fatal objection to the institution as an institution. Its suppression was necessary and incontestably simplified the elaboration and making of laws. The nation, tired of chatterings and utopian ideas, had one wish alone: to rest from its agitations in the institutions which it expected from the man in whom its trust had been placed. It saw with displeasure the opposition which was raised against him, and applauded this change in the Constitution. Speculative minds have asserted that Napoleon only suppressed the tribunate because he wished to rid himself of an inconvenient censor, and because he hated any publicity of discussion. Others more impartial have found that, on the contrary, by this measure, the legislative body was restored to the full exercise of its powers, and that the new method of discussion, which was adopted guaranteed better legislation by doing away with those parliamentary quarrels, which kept alive an agitation which was fatal to the steady progress of the government. The examination of the projected laws was, as a matter of fact, delegated to committees chosen from the legislative body and including its most experienced members. The Council of State drew up the draft bills and discussed them with the committees. In case of disagreement, the sections of the Council of State and the committees of the legislative body used to meet under the precedence of the Arch-Chancellor or of the Arch-Treasurer to come to an understanding. The Speaker for the Council of State expounded the reasons of the law to the legislative body. The President of the Parliamentary Committee was next heard. When the matter had been sufficiently discussed, a vote was taken. If the committee of the legislature did not consider the proposed law acceptable, each of the members of the committee was free to explain his objection before the chamber. The legislature was accordingly vested with the necessary authority and independence, and the examination of the bills remained entrusted to the pick of its members.